element in China was mostly export-oriented, manufacturing and export-oriented, but they've done a pretty big transition. And now if you're looking for capital for a deal, you always need to have some initiatives in China. Sure. So we have been working on these initiatives, and we have kept in touch with the CCPIT, with the China Chamber of Commerce. Unfortunately, it's a trade war between the US and China right now. It's a very difficult situation, but we have done our best to continue the relationship, and we do hope that China does see Puerto Rico as sort of a strategic partner in the Caribbean, sort of as a resource that they could basically leverage on Puerto Rico's incentives, and much as in the same way that there's other investment destinations in the U.S. that have received a significant amount, even in Silicon Valley. You know, there's been a lot of Chinese investors coming in. So in the Chamber of Commerce, we aim to develop these direct relationships and support efforts such as what Roderick Miller in Invest Puerto Rico is doing to promote Puerto Rico as an investment destination all around the world.
That's great. Yeah. And as manufacturing maybe wants to come home and be domestic, Puerto
Correct.
Rico is a great sector for investment. Maybe talk more about the opportunity there.
Yes. Well, you know, because of the reshoring initiative, that was already even before COVID. There was a big push to bring manufacturing back into the United States.
Yes.
From the point of view of national security, there are certain sectors where we do need to have our own production in the area of electronics, in terms of software, in terms of medicine, healthcare. Mm-hmm. And now with COVID, we got a pretty hard lesson with yes. regards to the impact of the global supply chain. And we don't necessarily need to focus on the extremely value-added products. Mm-hmm. We need to focus on products like such as PPE mm-hmm. and other areas which we normally see that as a very low value added product.
With PPE.
But PPE is personal protection equipment.
Got it.
It's all of these things such as masks and surgical, you know, the gear to protect ourselves. There was a huge crisis related to that in January, February. Once this thing blew up in China first,
yes.
There was a lot of dislocations with regards to the global supply chain with regards to that. And as you know, some of the communities and states in the United States, they really had a pretty big impact from COVID as a result of that. And there's also a lot of new therapies and a lot of new, for example, the vaccines that are being yes. developed. A lot of these technologies, you know, in the U.S., U.S. has been a leader. The United States has been a leader in a lot of these sectors, but a lot of the critical components of the manufacturing for pharmaceutical and medical devices has been sort of offshored into some lower cost investment destinations. And when you do that, and then you have a supplier that's on the other side of the world that's supplying something that you need as a component.
Yeah.
If you cannot find that, then you cannot provide the finished product.
Interesting.
As a result, Puerto Rico's proposal is to leverage on our existing infrastructure here, because we, in terms of the United States jurisdiction, Puerto Rico is the biggest producer, manufacturer of pharmaceutical products, more than any state.
Wow.
And a lot of people don't know that.
More than any state.
More than any single state. Puerto Rico manufactures more pharmaceutical products than any single state of the U.S. We're actually like number two or number three after the whole U.S. and after Germany. I think we're like number three.
Wow.
In terms of the actual output of pharmaceutical products. And because in Puerto Rico, as you know, we have a very high value-added operation where you have a lot of these active pharmaceutical ingredients imported into Puerto Rico. Then you have the intellectual property, which is all these patents and all of these,
sure.
You know, all this technology and innovation that is being implemented and commercialized here in Puerto Rico to add value to those products. And then based on that value added, we have a very solid set of tax incentives that for the pharmaceutical industry and medical device industry has been taking advantage. You know, they've been sort of taking these opportunities for already 40 or 50 years. So this,
wow.
this goes back to the 60s and 70s when Puerto Rico had this transition from agro industry to the high technology and pharmaceutical area. But you mentioned the 2022s. That's a relatively new sector for us in Puerto Rico to attract. But according to all of these studies done, it has the highest level of return on investment of any other sector. So that's why, in terms of which areas we would like to focus with regard to investment in the chamber during my year, we definitely put a very high priority on the 2022s.
So something you just keyed in on, and I know we had talked on our pre-call that is so important is history. If you don't know your history, you will repeat it, right? So you just started to say how significant the shift from agriculture to manufacture. Maybe fill in a little bit on how we got to where we're at and to something that happened in 2006, and maybe just give some context for those that are tuning in that maybe don't know the history here.
Yes. Well, as you know, Puerto Rico... We were part of the sort of the Industrial Revolution, but first we had a very, this goes back to the time of the Spanish, you know, we were a Spanish colony up until 1898. And we had a pretty big agriculture industry here for coffee, for sugar cane, you know, and other crops here in Puerto Rico. However, these were very, very low value-added products, where there were some other countries, such as Brazil, for example, Argentina, and certain countries, where the U.S. had a better trade relationship than with Puerto Rico itself. So as a result, it was very difficult for us to maintain these industries, such as coffee, especially given the natural disasters that we've had since the 1930s, we had a lot of hurricanes that hit Puerto Rico in those decades.
Got it.
And these were very tough to keep our coffee industry alive. At one point, the Puerto Rico was the sixth largest coffee exporter in the whole world.
Wow.
You know, in terms of the actual production, we were at about 600,000 bags of coffee, which is,
wow.
In nowadays, we produce about 60,000 bags of coffee. Okay. So you can just give you an idea of the space that we have, the raw land that we have available to plant high value added crops such as coffee.
Yes.
We have it, but it's just not viable as much, not as attractive as before. However, there are some new areas such as hemp, and that's where the 2022s, and there's been a lot of people that have been working specifically with hemp. Because there's also the cannabis, right? Medical cannabis, which is a very good commercial opportunity.
Yes.
But with hemp, because it's part of the farm bill, you know, it's already pretty much legal across all the U.S. And it has a very high value added component as well. So these are some of the sectors that are very niche markets that are sort of coming up. And so we basically support all of these. Now, we did have an industrial revolution, and the advancement was in the 60s and 70s and 80s, right?
Sure.
Where this was a groundbreaking model in the whole world. We were the first ones to do this.
Got it.
And we had the people from Singapore, the Singapore Ministry of Commerce, and the you know, very high-level people from Singapore. They actually visited Puerto Rico in the 1950s to learn from our model.
Wow.
And they based Singapore's economic development model on Puerto Rico.
Wow.
And, you know, so of course they have been very successful.
Yes, they have.
They've had the advantage of having a very strong government, you know, it's like a totalitarian government. So, you know, is to have the advantage of like a free market economy with a government that has a plan that they say they're going to do something and they do it.
Yeah.
And then everybody agrees on what is the best strategy to do it, and then they just do it, you know? In Puerto Rico, as you know, as happens with the mainland U.S., you know, there's different views in terms of how to do things, and there has been sort of an increasing polarity, even in Puerto Rico, with regards to decision-making and public policy, and that has definitely hurt us because it has affected the continuity of public policy in Puerto Rico in terms of what is the strategy for growth, for economic development, and in the chamber, we try to provide the continuity to these plans, because regardless of which government is in charge, and if it's the blues or the reds, you know, whoever it is, economic development is a formula that is, you know, like 2 + 2 = 4. I mean, it really, it's based on productivity.
Sure.
It's based on, you know, jobs. It's based on working.
Sure.
And not on, you know, certain types of support, like, you know, types of government subsidies and these type of areas, which tend to serve as sort of a crutch to the economy. So even though we've been hit with disasters and there's a lot of aid and a lot of funding that is coming, especially with COVID, that can be a very big support. But in terms of the initiatives that we're working on, it's related to direct investment into Puerto Rico, directed to manufacturing high value added products. It's related to export. It's related to tourism as well. Those are the very high growth, the high economic impact sectors. And then you have education as well, which we're really fighting to avoid sort of the brain drain of having graduates of Puerto Rico. They're all going out to NASA, and that's great. But we like to have them come back. They'd like to come back to Puerto Rico and innovate here and form ventures and, you know, network with some of these 2022s that are here in Puerto Rico now. These are some very good opportunities. It's a very big challenge given the Maria. You know, Maria, there was a lot of big exodus of people from Puerto Rico that actually had to leave. Now with COVID, it may be a little bit the opposite, you know, because in Puerto Rico, we've had a very good experience, you know, in terms of the compared to the mainland. You know, there have been, and now in Florida, the news in Florida is very, very concerning.
Yeah.
That maybe people may see Puerto Rico sort of as a safe haven.
Sure.
With regards to that. And I do believe that we may have an influx of people coming into Puerto Rico.
That's great. So I know that after Hurricane Maria, there was kind of an exodus of Puerto Ricans to the U.S. just because of electricity and kind of left a hole in the economy. And as you kind of pointed out, another kind of an interesting fact, I moved down here a couple of years ago for Act 2022 and have just found the people to be very warm and so the same with the temperature. But another interesting fact was like how many engineering students that like you guys produce and just the amount of students that go to Ivy League schools. It's just, so I guess the question that I'm alluding to is, you know, how do we avoid, you know, the drain to the states and that temptation and, you know, keep these positions and jobs and create a thriving economy back here that, you know, wants to attract that talent and not
sure.
Do that?
The answer to that is capital. You know, if you don't have a strong venture capital, private equity ecosystem here in Puerto Rico, it's going to be very difficult to keep people. Because these young entrepreneurs, young individuals, the degree of innovation that could be developed is significant, right? However, this innovation needs capital, needs investors to support it and guide it and, you know, sort of channel these ideas. And in Puerto Rico, we were very highly dependent on the manufacturing, which we had banks with very, very fat bank accounts, you know, of enterprises that had, you know, tens of thousands of employees. And it was a model where we really didn't depend on capital. We were mostly working on bank financing and liquidity. There was a lot of liquidity. But after the 936, Section 936 ended, a lot of these big operations that were very labor-intensive operations, they left Puerto Rico, and it had a very strong impact to our banking system, right? That was the really first impact. That was around 2004 to 2006,
okay,
where we had the first big hit from the phasing out of 936. So then and we
what
got
What was
hit.
That, just to give some context to
Well, in terms audience. Of the bank, in Puerto Rico, all of these pharmaceutical operations that I had in Puerto Rico, and a lot of these gains, these gains that these companies were achieving in Puerto Rico, they had them invested in Puerto Rico. So all of this capital was being
Stayed
multiplied
here.
And it was being invested in Puerto Rico in the banks as well. So the banks were able to provide very cheap financing and credit to the local community and the local investment community and the local sector. However, when this ecosystem of the banks having a lot of liquidity dried out, you had a lot of banks going under. You had a lot of banks. It became very difficult to get capital. It was really not related to the 2008 recession, you know,
okay,
to the whole crash.
Yes.
It was really not related to that. When that hit, we were already down. We were already affected. It did affect us globally, though, in terms of the investment environment globally. It took a big hit.
Sure.
And it's been very difficult to recover. If you combine that with the extremely inefficient fiscal and government structure in Puerto Rico, it's, you know, if you look at, for example, PREPA and a lot of the government or government structure that is very inefficient, it's understandable that the government would be bankrupt in terms of all of these debt obligations that they underwent. They couldn't pay them anymore. And then already starting 2013, 2014, 2015, we were already pretty much nearing bankruptcy. We were already seeing the downgrades. And then that affected us even more because the economic development, well, the government policy, it relied on these refinancings of these debt issuance. And because we had the downgrade and eventual bankruptcy, you know, the default, it really dried out all of these sources of refinancing financing. So when that pool of capital also got affected, then we were basically on our own. And that's when this ecosystem of the venture capital and private equity has developed. And that's when you have Act 185, which is it developed. It allowed the creation of these local vehicles with these tax incentives. And that has been sort of a help to prevent some of this local talent from leaving. But it's not enough. We need more people. We need more bodies down here in Puerto Rico, people that are coming to produce, like those 2022s, people that are coming here to invest, to buy homes, to, you know, contract and build their hopes. You know, there, in terms of the level of contracting and building and construction for the 2022s, it's been very significant. In terms of professional services being hired locally, there's entire companies that get the bulk of their income is coming from this sector. And that just gives you an idea of what of an impact that this segment has. Even though you're walking around, you don't really see them. It's not a physical presence, such as Amgen's $2 billion plant in Gurabo. You know, it's or in Juncos, I think. You don't really see it, but you can feel it. And that's one of the reasons, for example, Invest Puerto Rico and Roderick Miller, he's really focusing on this sector as one of the highest ROIs. And then Manuel Lavoy also, he's been also very actively working to promote additional investment in this sector.
That's great. Very intriguing. You're right. I think there is a misconception on the island regarding some of these incentives and the impact that it's making. So you highlighting that, I think, is very useful for those that are watching, because if you're like, you know, many people out there, you don't understand the economic impact sometimes because it's not visible, as you're saying. Maybe hit a little bit on there if there's somebody out there that's maybe unsure if these incentives are really favoring, because maybe the tax incentive, like the people are coming down here, they have lower taxes, which is what's bringing them to the island. Maybe just hit on the economic kind of like thought process on that to maybe on how you see it.
Well, the biggest advantage of coming to Puerto Rico is not even the taxes, it's more the labor pool in Puerto Rico. In terms of any investment operation that's coming into Puerto Rico and you're trying to set up any kind of business operation, sure, you need the human capital here in Puerto Rico. You need, yes, the people to execute the ideas, right? So that's one of the advantages. And unanimously, all of the manufacturing operations that are coming to Puerto Rico or professional services, service export, they rely on that local, yeah, talent pool that's in Puerto Rico. So even though, yes, we're sort of fighting the brain drain of having people go out into the States, There is an ample amount, yeah, of local talent that is available. And then, of course, there's the perks of all of these tax incentives that are available. And with Act 60, it has been a groundbreaking, code of investment code, because all of these various different ragtag bunch of laws that were there, like 2022, you had 135, you had 185, you had 399 for the insurance, and you had the international banks, you had the offshore insurance. You had all these, loose,
sure,
ragtag bunch of codes, and you had Act 74, which I believe is for tourism. You, yep, had 73, which is for manufacturing. So all of that got put into one code, and there's a lot of streamlining with regards to that, and I believe that gives us a very good tool for investment promotion.
Got it.
But the only thing that we don't have is investing and promoting and actually putting the government money for investment promotion.
Got it.
And that's something that has been sort of in the decline. Puerto Rico's government used to have representative offices all around the world.
Sure.
And I was actually, in 1995, I visited Puerto Rico's office in Tokyo.
Sure.
Just to give you an idea, we had an office in Tokyo, we had an office in Frankfurt, we had an office in Silicon Valley, we had an office in New York. And in all of these different origins of, sure, of capital, we had permanent representation. And we were on a first-name basis with all of the CEOs of all of these different companies. And we still have that relationship, but it's remote. We're like 5,000 miles away. We're not going to be as effective,
correct,
as if we had an office there, as if we're participating in every single event,
sure,
as if we're going to
your face
the headquarters,
there,
their events at their headquarters, and, yeah, reach out and touch them. So I think it's very important for us to have that presence,
yeah,
globally. I think it's a must. All of our competitors have it. You know, because even if we were a state or if we're an island, we can still have these representative offices.
Sure.
And if you look at, for example, Florida, you know, California, all of these states have multiple offices all around the world that are representing them. And then you have countries that, yeah, are, that we're competing with. Like, for example, you say Costa Rica,
sure,
or Dominican Republic. All of these countries have their own embassies, consulates, you know, NGOs that are in chambers of commerce that they're just covering, they're wrapping the whole world two or three times over. And it's very hard for us to not be present in any of these initiatives to go out and directly meet with investors. You know, so yeah, we're talking about here in Puerto Rico, Loisa Street, right? Once you're here, once you land it, you're here, right? But yes, to get people to come here, I think people locally don't realize how hard that is to do, because there is a lot of competition.
For sure.
And we receive a lot of delegations from many countries, even from China. We receive a delegation from China. And I always ask him, hey, where are you going after this? And I'm like, oh, after this, we're going to the Dominican Republic. After this, we're going to Jamaica. After this, we're going to Mexico. So we're not the only game in town. You Correct. Know, the people shop around.
Of course.
And now with this 2022 thing with the $5,000 fee, that's definitely something that we really need to look into to make sure that it's not establishing a precedent for that could sort of erode the trust between the investor community here in Puerto Rico. That's sort of an issue that we're working. It's on the news these days.
So let's hit on that. And sure. I think you're right, because proper incentives is really what brings somebody down here, and that's what you're alluding to. So this is kind of a hot like news topic at the moment, and I know that you're supportive of going from this appeal as an Act 22 or myself. You know, having the fee go up to $5,000 puts a lot of pressure, right? Friends that are reconsidering staying on the island as a result because of the economics of it. So maybe hit on, maybe a little bit more detail on what is going on and your stance on it, and we could start from there.
Sure. Well, as you know, the chamber through the committee with Annie's initiative, we have contacted all of the former secretaries of economic development, and except one, for that group, the consensus has been unanimous with regards to the against appeal. This fee raise, the raise in the fee, which is due to a law that was passed recently that mandates this fee to be going from $300 to $5,000 a year. And Act 60 also had some provisions for the new decree holders that they had to go for the Act 22s. Now they have to do the $10,000, $5,000 a year donation. Now it's going up to $10,000. So in terms of the costs for a family of four, for example, that actually they all have decrees, it would be a multiplying effect of that. And in some cases, people now they have to pay $20,000, they have to pay $40,000 just in fees alone. And there is a perception in the main community in Puerto Rico and the people that are really not as informed that the 2022s are like millionaires, they're all like sure. totally rolling and 50-foot yachts coming in, and it's not really like that. Everybody is looking for an investment destination but also for living destination sure. to go and move.
Yes.
And all of these people, they're not necessarily like income producing initiatives. A lot of these initiatives are capital that they're bringing into Puerto Rico or capital gains, for example, and that's related to the opportunity zone type projects here in Puerto Rico. But we're just focusing on innovation and productivity, right? So when you look at that, it does have a little bit of an impact with regards to the community that could be coming here to Puerto Rico. So that's when we had the initiative, and this is with the coordination of Annie, to reach out to these former secretaries of economic development. And then we have prepared sort of an initiative, which is not a legal-based initiative, right? Because there are some other options, such as legal options, and you Sure. could go and fight this in court. But we have actually not decided to go that route because it's going to really take a long time to decide that. And at the same time, it's going to be a very negative aspect of it. And right now, this news is already on the newspaper, the local newspapers here in Puerto Rico. But if this were to hit, Wall Street Journal, Bloomberg, Reuters, this could really have a very big impact. And this is not something that we would really like to promote you know, in terms of the fact that we have this sort of dispute with regards to this rule. And these are some of the concerns that we have relayed to Manuel Laboy, who's the Secretary of Economic Development. And just today, we wrote a letter to him where we attached, we did a survey, and we had about 26 of the local 22s, including yourself.
Yeah.
Your letter is in there. It's attached to our letter.
Got it.
Signed by Annie and myself to convey these concerns, you know, and frustrations from this local investment community that this local, you know, there are people like you and me, you know, who are you and me.
Exactly.
And they're coming here to Puerto Rico to invest, to contribute, to hire, to spend, to buy. And, you know, there is a lot of frustration with regards to this fee raise. Yep. And our proposal to Laboy basically is, yes, the law is the law, but you can implement it on next year. You can hold off on implementing it until next year.
Yeah.
And there may be an opportunity to amend the law next year. This year, as you know, the legislative session finishes in June 30.
Okay.
So because it's an election year. So if the law wasn't amended up until these days, there's no chance to amend it until next year.
Got it.
But in terms of the implementation of the fee rate, the rate hike, it could be put off till next year. So that's sort of what we're asking to do that.
It's reasonable.
And that sort of gives us a little bit more time to regroup and have a more concerned effort. But right now, there have been some people that are just frustrated and have been talking about just leaving Puerto Rico, which I also think is not a wise idea. I do think that, you know, of course, as I mentioned initially, the tax incentives are one of the main drivers of having people come to Puerto Rico, but there's other aspects as well of coming to invest in Puerto Rico. If you compare with other investment destinations in Latin America, for example, here we have the highest, the more highly qualified talent pool here in Puerto Rico. We have a very high safety, you know, with regards to other countries.
Correct.
And even compared to other cities in the U.S., you know, I've lived in New York for 5 years. I know it gets pretty dicey out there, you know, so definitely. And we live in paradise, you know. This is like, it's a tropical paradise.
The beach is two blocks this way.
You know, have you seen some of the homes that these guys have? You know, it's like you live in paradise, you're working from here. You know, it's a very envious position that some of these resident investors have.
Sure.
And as you know, you're living here in Puerto Rico. We're an island time. Things take a little bit longer to do, but it's because the stress level is way down.
Sure.
When I was living in New York, I was living in a box, you know? Yeah. I was living in a box paying $2,000-$3,000 a month.
Yep.
And that was 20 years ago.
Sure.
You know, I have since visited a lot of my former coworkers in New York. And the quality of life in New York is not necessarily any higher than it was. It has actually been degrading because of the increasing cost of living in New York and decreasing, you know, just quality of life has been a solid decline. And if you look at the banking, for example, Wall Street and the banking sector in New York, there has been a lot of cost cutting. And it's not like the glamour jobs from Wall Street in the 80s. It's not like, you know, the movie Wall Street where you're trading and, you know, dump the stocks and this kind of thing. It's not like that anymore. You know, it's really, it's a grunge job, you know, to work in Wall Street. And there's a lot of sacrifices that people have to make. And if you're going to do that, you might as well move to Puerto Rico and set up an Act 20 export services operation and sell and have your clients to be in Wall Street. And you export the services and you pay like a 4% tax. And that's a pretty good deal. And then your costs in Puerto Rico are going to be a lot lower. For the same $4,000 that you pay a month to live in a box in New York, you could live like in a huge pad here in Puerto Rico.
Close to the beach, weather's good. The weather's good.
Yeah, good weather. We do have the hurricane season, right? It does get a little dicey here. It's starting soon, right? But, you know, we're very resilient, too.
Yes.
After so many hurricanes and so many disasters that we've had, you know, in terms of all these storms passing through, in terms of the construction here in Puerto Rico, it's become very resilient. And you have a lot of renewable energy that's very freely available. So with Maria, of course, that was a big hit.
Yeah.
It's a lot of people that were not ready for that. But since then, there has been a lot of preparation with regards to our network in Puerto Rico and with regards to people's homes in terms of the different things that they can set up.
Yeah.
So we're going to be really ready for the next one. So I think that, you know, having said all of that, I do believe that Puerto Rico is a good investment destination. And with this ecosystem, these different groups, for example, like Uncommon Entrepreneurs, it's really good to, it's very easy to very quickly develop a very strong network of contacts. And you're learning from other people's successes or mistakes. In terms of all the amount of information that's freely available, in terms of all the different networking opportunities, the people that have been there, tried that, done that, And they will tell you, you know, you need a tailor, I can give you 10 people that do it. You need a bank, I give you a few. You need a CPA, you know, we can do that. So this is pretty fast that the local investors can get onboarded pretty fast.
Yeah, I think that's a very good information and is a major goal with what we're doing in Uncommon Entrepreneurs is connect the dots when you arrive with, you know, locals and those that have lived down here to, you know, bridge that gap because it speeds up the process and increases retention and all that. And another key point you just made with, you know, Act 20, now Act 60, with the whole export service side of things as, you know, a person that, like, I guess I consider myself a digital nomad where, like, I don't physically have to be somewhere to be doing what I'm doing. What a perfect destination next to the tropics where, you know, if your industry doesn't require you to have to show up in an office and pay the New York rent, you can be here. I think great point just to reinforce.
And now after COVID, actually, because remote working now is sort of the norm.
It is.
It is easier for these resident investors and technology and all the sectors. It's so much easier for them to come to Puerto Rico and relocate. Nobody's going to even know that they moved down here because you could have a presence, a remote presence, and you could be productive. And because that is sort of accepted nowadays to work remotely, it's even easier to move down to Puerto Rico right now.
Yeah, you're right. The infrastructure's in place, you know.
Yes. In terms of fiber optic, I mean, Puerto Rico has a lot of fiber optic network in terms of the reliability of that network. After Maria specifically, you know, a lot of the local technology companies have invested a lot in 5G also as well, and their satellite solutions as well. You know, so in the chamber, we have a couple of these companies that are also setting up the satellite networking sort of as a backup of the backup of the backup. You know, so if you really have a very mission critical type operation in Puerto Rico, there's many ways to have a very strong, resilient operation.
Sure. Yep. So I comment, link, share if this is intriguing information. There's plenty of people out there that need to hear what you're explaining. And, you know, comment below, like, additional questions if you have any. We definitely want to do that. And any other themes, I think a takeaway, too, is if you think having Roderick with Invest PR would be, if that would be something you're interested in, let us know. I think that you're kind of hitting that. That makes a lot of sense. You know, kind of along that theme of, you know, in you're out there, you have an Asia presence, you're here, you're in the midst of things. How can the island kind of be better, like, as an international investment promotion, or just, you know, how?
As I mentioned earlier, in terms of the budget, you know, that, for example, Invest Puerto Rico has is really not significant. It's just about $4 to $5 million a year. It really is a fraction of what Dominican Republic is spending or Costa Rica is spending.
Sure.
Costa Rica has a building full of people. They're spending, or Colombia, they're just to promote coffee. Colombia spends like $230 or $250 million a year just for coffee alone.
What's
just to
ROI?
Give you an idea. It's huge. Coffee, come on, it's huge. And that's the legal crop that they do. There's other crops, right? But in terms of coffee, I'm very impressed because I've also worked on trade promotion, right? Export promotion. So I've actually exhibited Puerto Rico coffee alongside Colombia coffee, Brazil coffee, all of these different coffees from all around the world in Asia, in all of the major food shows. And it's very impressive as to what the level of investment that these other countries do and they make with regards to trade promotion. And investment promotion, right? And in Puerto Rico, we really need to support more this aspect. And entities such as Invest Puerto Rico do need to have a lot more support financially. And I know that the model is going to be, there's a transition from strictly government promotion to have this NGO, which is Invest Puerto Rico, right? However, to let that baby go out and fly on its own, you need to sort of give them the you know, you need to let them grow. You need to nurture. And because it's right, you're just born, you're not going to slap them on the butt and say, hey, you're on your own.
Yeah.
Do what you need to do. You need to sort of let that grow organically.
Yes.
And you need to support it. And with the current budgeting, I think it's very limiting. And as I mentioned to you, we need to have a permanent presence in all of these major markets for capital. And for trade, consumer markets, for example, China is a very big consumer market, even though we have a trade war, the U.S. has a trade war, but there are a lot of big consumer markets, and in Puerto Rico, you know, anybody that's manufacturing in Puerto Rico to sell only in Puerto Rico, they're leaving a lot on the table. Because, you know, you have a captive community, but it's just 3 million people. you know. And if you're looking at China, for example, there's about 200 million people in China that have a purchasing power that's higher than the average in the U.S. So if you think about it, you know, that just gives you an idea of the niche areas in China and Singapore, Hong Kong, Taiwan, all these different regions and states and regions that could be a target. And you're not even looking at Europe yet. You're not looking at some of the niche markets in the States as well, or Latin America, where you could, you know, manufacture here and export. But you do need to have a presence, a permanent presence. And of course, Invest Puerto Rico would be a good tool, coordinating, of course, with the economic development in Puerto Rico and the Chamber of Commerce and Manufacturers Association and all these different other groups that are in Puerto Rico. I think it's very important.
Yeah, that's good. I see where you're going with that. So maybe talking about like the hospitality industry and the tourism industry, you know, how do you see that, you know, developing with, you know, as we're in this COVID era and things are adjusting, and, you know, how can we maybe improve that? And I know you're working on some initiatives.
Yeah, well, hospitality industry has taken a huge hit because of COVID. You know, in terms of the revenue drop is in some cases up to 95%. And of course, you know, there's a very big investment community with regards to the Airbnb type investments here in Puerto Rico. There's different investment projects where you buy a whole building and you have, you know, 20 or 30 different properties that you have purchased, you have rehabilitated them, you have renovated them, you have furnished them. Yep. It's a very significant investment. Sure. And it's a sort of a transfer of wealth from outside of Puerto Rico into Puerto Rico. I'm very, very grateful of the commitment that a lot of these resident investors have been coming here into Puerto Rico and bringing all this capital and wealth into Puerto Rico, right? If you look at Old San Juan, for example, in terms of you cannot walk through down a single block and not have a building being renovated at any single time.
Sure.
There's every single of these historic buildings in Old San Juan. They're all getting renovated. And right now, Old San Juan is like, on the books, it's like, 14 to 20% of all Old San Juan is already Airbnb, right?
Wow.
So that just gives you an idea of the impact.
Yeah.
And when you look at it, when you really want to renovate your own building, it's very expensive because these are historic buildings.
Yeah.
But Airbnb, for example, it gives you the ability and the feasibility to be able to do that.
Justify the investment.
But in terms of the traditional hotels in Puerto Rico, they've taken a big hit. As you know, in Puerto Rico, we've had casinos for quite a while, and casinos was a very big source of income for the hotels. But since there was a video lottery type, like the private lottery machines that you can set up on gas stations and pharmacies and convenience stores, those have eaten away a lot of the revenue from the hotels. And it's been incredibly difficult for hotels to be profitable and to be competitive with other tourism destinations such as the Dominican Republic, where you could travel there. They're very low cost. They don't have to follow the same labor laws that we have to follow in Puerto Rico. So it's very, very economical to go to Punta Cana or some of these other, even in the Caribbean, some of the islands. So there are a lot of challenges in the tourism sector.
Sure.
And with COVID right now, it does seem like the tourism volume is not really going to pick up at all, probably until September, October, November.
Got it.
And we do hope to for the high season again, come December. We do hope to have things back online, but it is going to take a long time. There has been a pretty big dislocation with regards to the employees on the hotel sector getting furloughed.
Sure.
You know, so we really don't want to have a drain of that very specialized talent in the hospitality sector here in Puerto Rico. Because it does take a while to become proficient in the hospitality sector.
Yeah.
There's people that go to college for that and many years of experience. And if these hotels were to shut down for much longer, a lot of these people, they just can't wait around. They're going to have to go and move somewhere. So this is one of the big challenges that the industry faces. And of course, we go back to the actual tourism promotion.
Sure.
There's the DMO, right, which has been working on these initiatives. They have received a lot of financial support recently, though. With COVID, they did receive some earmarks of the funding, and also through the CDBG program, the Community Development Block Grant program, they have also received some funding. And I know that Brad Dean, for example, he's the spearhead of that project, which is coming from the Convention Bureau, which is an entity that my father was the founding chairman of the Convention Bureau in Puerto Rico. And this is, I believe, back in the 70s and 80s. You know, and it's a lot of effort. It does require a lot of investment, and it does require the government to sort of put their money where their mouth is in terms of financing that promotion network, because it is, you need to promote. There's other competitors, there's other players in this space for tourism. Players that don't follow the same rules that we have, they don't have the same costs that we have in Puerto Rico.
Sure.
It does cost more to run a hotel in Puerto Rico. The situation with the permits is very challenging. In the chamber, we have a committee, holy committee just for permits this year.
Yeah, let's talk about that. I know you were hitting.
We had a pretty big initiative with regards to that with Alicia Lamboy, who's our one of our ex-presidents, and she's an expert in the permit sector. And we have been working very hard with the ruling for the permits and the law. And we have had a lot of interaction with Manuel Lavoy, who's also the chairman of the permit agency. He's sort of the overlord of all these different silos in the government, and he also deals with permits. And we have also had a lot of meetings with him to provide amendments to the rule and amendments to the laws, and we have been working very closely with that. But it is still a very difficult environment in Puerto Rico to get permits. With the single business permit, you know, the portal, it has streamlined some of the processes, but there is still a lot of hurdles that need to be passed with regards to permits. And if you were to say want to open a hotel in Puerto Rico, it would still take a long time, and that is a very big drawback to investing. So this is some of the things when you're going to open a business in Puerto Rico, you do need to do a lot of research and talk with your local legal help, accounting help, labor help as well. Labor is also one area where in Puerto Rico we have some very particular labor laws, you know, that the chamber has been consistently trying to sort of bring at a par with what is going on in the U.S., where you have at-will employment. So it's a lot more flexible with regards to the level of employment and the workforce that a company would need to have. In Puerto Rico, it's a lot more inflexible in terms of the ability for the company to scale up or scale down their workforce. And it's a little bit more challenging in that sense. So these are some of the things that the chamber has been working on with taxes, you know, labor law, and also with energy. The energy costs, we have also been very active on the energy sector, specifically opposing the RSA, which is a restructuring support agreement, which could hike rates up to 10 cents per kilowatt hour. So if that were to happen, Puerto Rico would be easily the highest cost energy cost jurisdiction in probably in the whole world. Probably maybe North Korea or Afghanistan or one of these countries may have a more inefficient structure than us. But, you know, we're Puerto Rico. We're supposed to be leading edge. We're supposed to have the best infrastructure. And that is sort of a deterrent to some of these bigger manufacturing operations to come to Puerto Rico because of the high energy costs. And there is a very strong mandate from the private sector for the sort of the privatization of the power production, you know, the electrical production here in Puerto Rico, so that it would be done in a more efficient manner. And of course, a lot of these renewable sectors have been coming in terms of the legislation. They do mandate a transition to anywhere from 50 to 100% of renewable energy. There's sort of a timeline to do that. And it's very aggressive because I don't believe any other country has mandated a transition to 100% renewables. But we do have sort of a target towards 100%. But for the next 15 years, there's a very strong transition using gas-based energy generation. So it's right now we're using mostly oil, right? Oil, which is very inefficient. And a lot of our electrical generating capacity is fueled by oil, which is very inefficient. It contaminates highly. So it should be a short-end transition for 10 to 15 years using gas, and then renewables, which are going to be becoming very cheap later on.
Got it. Yeah. And so on the alternative energy side, there's a lot of sun in Puerto Rico. What are your thoughts on solar? How do you see
it's
that?
It's a lot of sun, a lot of wind. There's other areas, the ocean energy, that's one of the big initiatives with economic development. In terms of ocean energy, we have the tides, we have the waves. There's a lot of, we have hydrothermal, we have a lot of different areas where we can produce. And you look at a country such as Costa Rica that I believe they're already at 100% renewable right now. And there's some countries that have made a very good transition. So Puerto Rico, I'm sure that we can do that. But there is the infrastructure. There's that white elephant, which is PREPA, which we really need to figure out a way to sort of put it out to pasture and have a better participation in the private sector.
Yeah.
Create using a private, public-private partnerships.
Sure.
To have a lot of this electrical generation and transmission and distribution specifically was included as part of the RSA. You know, in terms of the transmission and distribution PPP was a precondition of that was the RSA getting signed and approved. So because of the RSA not being viable, it's really delaying a lot of the, you know, the revitalization of the energy sector here in Puerto Rico.
Got it. And you're not running for governor. I'm kind of surprised by
this. Not yet. It's really tough.
You want to see him on the bill.
No, that would just spoil me. You know, that was just how to say it. In Spanish you say me daña. That would just ruin me. You know, if I get into that, it's just.
I get it.
I don't know. I'm pretty happy in terms of where I am in the private sector.
Yeah.
Free trade. Yes, we want to sort of foster a very strong economic policy, right? And have the government listen to us.
Yeah.
It has been very challenging, but we have been very effective, especially with COVID and with the executive order for the closings and the curfew, right? We have been very vocal with regards to the opening up and doing that safely, but doing that in an ordered fashion. And we have been successful in achieving a control opening.
Got it.
And the level of cases has remained extremely low.
Yep.
And, you know, I believe we have been very successful. I would also like to congratulate the BEOC, which is a Business Emergency Operations Center that is led by my colleague Emilio Colon.
Got it.
And they have had three different subcommittees that are working on. And the first work stream, which is the immediate crisis management, that is presided by Alicia Lamboy, which is the same lady that I mentioned to you before.
Sure.
The group two is presided by Jaime Luis Fonalledas, which is the CEO of Plaza Las Americas. He's one of the top people in Plaza, right? And the third group is chaired by Eduardo Pagan from the TOTE Maritime, and he's also from the Maritime Association, right? So this group has been very, very, it's sort of an economic task force. And this group, I'm part of the work stream three, which is sort of focused on long-term economic development initiatives, but focused to react and basically provide strategies to leverage and become more resilient with regards to emergencies, right? So this group is just wrapping up their work now, especially work stream one and two. They're pretty much wrapping up because we are already finishing the opening up of the economy. So I do congratulate them as well. Jaime Luis Fonalledas is one of the, he was awarded by the chamber as the business person of the year in Puerto Rico. So it's a top award for a Zenith Awards. And I just announced that to him yesterday.
Amazing.
And we're going to be coming up with this news, in the next few days.
That's great. So, so many different themes that we can kind of cover, and we're kind of, you know, wrapping things up maybe in the next 5 minutes or so. So maybe just what else kind of comes to mind that would be kind of good with initiatives you guys are working on and just and so forth?
Well, as you know, there's a lot of different initiatives in the chamber and mine personally that we are working on. My mantra basically is más allá del 100 por 35, which means you got to think outside of the box. Puerto Rico's geographical dimensions is 100 miles by 35 miles.
Got it.
So you want to think about, you need to go outside of this box, this geographical limitation.
Yes.
And when you think about solutions for investment, trade, tourism, education, research, you don't need to limit yourself to what's available here locally. You need to look at, you know, overseas for support, for capital, for know-how, you know, for innovation, for consumers, you know, buyers of the products. We cannot live in this fishbowl, beautiful fishbowl, which we call Puerto Rico, with that beautiful sand and beautiful fish in there. But we do have to sort of, at some point, we have to get out of this box and we have to reach out into the world. And most of my initiatives and my personal initiatives have been related to that.
Yes.
And it's really not easy because in Puerto Rico, as you know, we're here in Puerto Rico. The mentality is, hey, we're already in paradise. Why we need to go to travel at hoof it all the way up to Frankfurt or meet with somebody there or go to New York, meet with a delegation of Japanese companies or go to Hong Kong and do a food show? You know, it's really a lot of work to do that. And there's very few people. There's just a handful of people in Puerto Rico that are capable of doing this type of investment and trade promotion. So basically, these are some of the things that I'm going to be pushing in the coming years. My term at the Chamber of Commerce does conclude at June 30, and there will be an incoming president that has a specific agenda and plan for his year. However, the mission and vision of the Chamber of Commerce does continue. And then we do have a lot of continuity with regards to initiatives that we're doing and the types of events that we're doing in the areas such as healthcare, energy, you know, permits, taxes, all of these different areas we are really working in. We have a lot of continuity because the Chamber is composed of its members, which are all industry leaders of industry.
Got it. Wow. You guys, you have your hands in many different buckets.
Sure.
And many different, and is the Puerto Rico Chamber of Commerce, is there just one on the island or just each
there's
city?
There's three. There's the main, that's the Puerto Rico Chamber of Commerce, and there's one in south of Puerto Rico Chamber of Commerce, and there's the west Puerto Rico Chamber of Commerce. But for this first time in many years, we have developed a coalition of the three. And in terms of all of the lobbying efforts with the government, we have created this coalition of the Chambers of Commerce to have one voice with regards to the chambers. So each one of them operates independently. And actually, the south of Puerto Rico Chamber of Commerce opened before ours. They opened all the way in the 1800s.
Wow.
Was when they were founded. The Chamber of Commerce of Puerto Rico was founded in 1913. But we have created this coalition. There's also other associations, right? And the chamber has been also very active in the private sector coalition, which is a group of more than 30 associations and private colleges, you know, in terms of the professional colleges, such as the College of Engineers, College of CPAs, College of Surgeons. So all this, we have been very active in all of these various different groups to have outreach, to do lobbying activities. And even today, we're sending letters to LaBoy. And then yesterday, we had a hearing in Congress for a Department of Transportation infrastructure bill, where we're advocating Puerto Rico receive an additional $200 million of government spending for our roads. As you know, you drive in Puerto Rico,
yeah.
You know, you do get a, because of the tropical weather, you know, it is
yep.
very challenging to have roads that don't have, you know, potholes in them, right? So it does.
But just to clarify also, I mean, there's a whole like highway system set up that is very similar to what you'd find in the States.
Yes.
But there are some potholes.
Yes, there are some, and in terms of the level of government spending with regards to infrastructure, we would like to see a higher, a slightly bigger amount that would be more in line with what gets spent in the U.S., and we're actively lobbying in all of these different sectors.
That's amazing. Yeah, and sounds like you're seeing progress and you're, you know, fighting for the private sector, which
yes.
is, you know, the one that's really creating jobs and, you know, sustainably long-term.
Definitely.
So very good. Appreciate the time. If you were watching, you know, comment, you know, share. This is, you know, we need people on the island to understand what you're referring to because, you know, not everybody has the lens that you're coming from to understand all these waves and changes that are occurring that are really setting Puerto Rico up for a bright future.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the invitation. And
welcome.
I also congratulate you for developing Uncommon Entrepreneurs. I think it's, you know, together with Alex, right? Buddy Alex, right? Which I've also had a lot of, I've also shared a lot with him, a lot of different experiences with him in the last couple of years. And, you know, I do congratulate you. I think you have created a pretty good ecosystem here. And I do welcome you to continue collaborating with the Chamber and with Annie. You know, Annie may be presiding the committee for next year as well.
Amazing.
So we're sort of pushing for her to be able to continue that. And we will make an announcement. She will be making the announcement shortly. But in terms of the work done so far, I mean, it is really significant. And we have sort of set a base for all of these different initiatives.
Sure.
With the different groups that have been developing in Puerto Rico.
Yes.
And people will be looking to us as a resource. And we would ideally like to have more investors formally join the chamber
yep.
to get a better voice with regards to all of these initiatives that we're doing.
Yeah, and I think that connection, in which again is the backbone of why we even started Uncommon Entrepreneurs, whereas there was, you know, a lot of, you know, these investors that have moved down here in Puerto Rico, is that if just we're in the same room having a conversation, we're going to realize we're very similar.
Yes.
We have similar interests.
We face a lot of the same challenges.
Other.
Yes. We live next to each other. And then we have the same environment. We're all in the same box, right? 100 yes. by 35, right? And we all have the same needs.
Yes.
There's all the same similar opportunities. But working together, it does make the process a lot more efficient in terms of, as I mentioned, learning from other people's successes and mistakes. And it does make it a more enjoyable experience to be living here in Puerto Rico and being able to interact with people that have very similar interests.
I love it. So I appreciate you coming on.
Thank you for the time.
Jose. Yep. And how do people reach you?
Well, my Facebook page, you can reach me through there.
Good.
I'm already as a host on this event, so you can contact me through there. And I also have an email address, but if you contact me first through there, that would be pretty good. We can follow up through there.
Amazing. Very good. Appreciate you coming on.
Thank you.
Great times. And we'll be signing in next. We do this every Wednesday and Friday, bringing the top entrepreneurs and local talent. And we'll keep on going. If you have suggestions, right below, share. We'll be in touch. Thank you.
Thank you.